All right, Ms. Susette, we're ready.
Okay. Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the Financial Literacy Webinar Series on Effective Budgeting. My name is Susette Sabio-Jones, and I am the corresponding secretary. Are there any members of the Alamance-Guilford section present?
Georgia Shepherd.
Good evening. Good evening. My name is Margie McLean, and I'm the president of the Alamance-Guilford section.
Is there anyone else present from the Alamance-Guilford section? Okay.
Okay, next we will have a brief video that talks about NCNW from my youth. It will be called Sisterhood.
National Council of Negro Women is an organization of organizations founded in 1935 by Mary McLeod Bethune. We serve our national purpose and mission, which is to lead, develop, advocate, unify, and inform for ourselves and also for the community. With over 240 sections, NCNW continues to thrive. Sisterhood is growth. It's you meeting people and they changing your life in a positive way.
I like being independent, not so much of an investment.
I know that the passion and that love for helping the community and getting to know people with a like mind is essential for this organization to work, for any organization to work.
Since the beginning, from the time that I was initiated into the organization, all we've been involved in is community service, and I'm more than happy to be giving of myself to those who are less fortunate or to those who aren't able to receive the aspect of giving in any aspect of their lives.
NCNW means friendship, love, and happiness. Just a great time. In the near future, I want NCNW to mean more of a sisterhood to me, which I know it will. I truly love each member because their souls and hearts are pure and everyone is genuine as well.
And it's also about sisterhood. We've bonded so much. I can honestly say since I've joined the organization, I found my purpose in life, and it's to really give to others and to share love. And I really feel that with my sisters. It's really a oneness and different aspects. Like, everyone can bring in different things. Like, this one person who's humorous, another person who's chill and laid back, but we all embrace it and we put it together, and it really unifies us and makes us a sister and an actual organization and not just just a club.
Next, we'll hear some information about the Alamance-Guilford section.
Good evening, everyone. About us, the Alamance-Guilford section was chartered on April 10th, 2014. Section members participated in various endeavors which promote leadership development and training, champions women's rights and civil rights, educates the community on health disparities, promotes the positive growth of area youth and college students, provide and promotes educational opportunities, encourages the economic empowerment of women of African descent, and celebrates and strengthens the Black family. Since chartering, AGS has hit the ground running with planning events and creating community partnerships. Every month, the section adopts a community organization to support from the areas that served. Some of the organizations that have been supported are Safe Food Ministry, Community Family Abuse Shelters, Piedmont Health Services and Sickle Cell Agency, and Ladies of Quality Mentoring Program. We have also partnered with Allen Middle School in Greensboro, North Carolina, for their Family Holiday Adoptions Program. The Alamance-Guilford section has provided many programs to include a resume workshop, the mother-daughter fashion show tea to honor breast cancer survivors, and the annual It Takes a Village scholarship banquet, a financial freedom seminar, and hosted a CPR certification workshop. The Alamance-Guilford supports the Elon University and North Carolina A&T University Collegiate Sections. Now I'll introduce this our speaker, Dr. Shandra Parks. Dr. Parks is a licensed graduate social worker and has been working with children, youth, and families for the 20 years in the areas of child welfare, community social work, and ministry wellness. Dr. Parks is currently employed as a family involvement facilitator, resource home worker, and is a field instructor for MSW students with the University of Maryland School of Social Work. Dr. Parks is the owner of Soul to Soul Wellness, LLC, which is a holistic counseling and wellness practice. Dr. Parks works with adults in the areas of spiritual health, physical health, as well as financial and emotional literacy. Dr. Parks received a bachelor's degree in social work from Seton Hall University, master's degree in social work from Rutgers University, Christian Studies Diploma Jericho Christian Training Center, and Doctor of Philosophy in Clinical Christian Counseling from Family Bible Ministries Worldwide. Dr. Parks holds an additional certification in financial social work and international clergy problem gambling spiritual outreach certification. Dr. Parks is a member of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated, National Christian Counselors Association, and serves as vice president with the Maryland Council on Problem Gambling. Dr. Parks.
Thank you, everyone, and thank you for having me this evening. Before we get started, I'm just going to go ahead and share my screen so we can talk about effective budgeting. Can everyone see the screen? So once again, thank you everyone for having me this evening. This evening, we'll talk about effective budgeting and what will work well for you, because budgeting is all about your financial goals and what you would like to achieve in life. So this evening is going to be broken down into three sections, very small topics just to get you thinking. The first portion will be just about your money narrative. really looking at who am I as relates to money. The second area we'll talk about will be just money goals. Why do I want this abundance in my particular life? And number three is about our money budget. Like, what are the strategies that we're able to achieve the abundance that we need? So a quick question, and you can either put this in the chat or you can unmute yourself. This is an interactive, you know, conversation, but just a quick question just to get a pulse in the room. How do you feel about your current budget? Does your current budget make you feel overwhelmed? Does it make you feel sad or, you know, happy, or you look at it and say like, I can do a little bit more? How do you feel about your current budget? And the reason why I just asked this particular question, and you could chime in if you like, is that oftentimes when it comes to budgeting, people often feel like it's very restrictive. I feel like I can't do anything because I own a budget. I feel like I won't have enough money to do X, Y, and Z. And oftentimes those are some of the comments that I receive from some of the families that I work with. But tonight, it's my hope that we can do a little bit better, have a plan, and have an idea of where we can go. And oftentimes the budget just shows us a blueprint of where we need to increase and maybe some areas that we made to decrease. I saw in a comment that yes, that we need help. I need to do a little better. So we're going to have a little conversation and, you know, dialogue. So if you don't have a piece of paper, feel free to grab just a piece of paper so you can jot notes or things to think about, because we will have a question and answer period where we can have more dialogue and discussion and help you come up with a budgeting template that works for you, that you can stay with it and be consistent with it. And just to let you know, budgeting, when I first started budgeting, I was stressed out about budgeting. I was like, oh, why do I must I, what I must budget? So I kind of changed the word, you know, budget, but you can utilize whatever word you want. But I kind of utilize my own personal spending plan that kind of makes me feel a little bit better, that is more personal and doesn't feel so much restricted, but I have a sense of being able to tell where I want my money to go. So for those who are okay with the word budget, that's fine. If you like to be creative and develop your own personal spending plan, it gives a little bit more sense of empowerment. It gives you a little bit more sense of feeling, having a little bit freedom of what you're able to do with your money. So the first portion that I like to talk about with individuals, and feel free if you have any questions, if you want to chime in, I call this the money narrative. What is your money story? Who am I as relates to money? Oftentimes, and that's composed of our values. Like, what do you value when it comes to money? Do you value freedom? Do you value being able to give? Do you value of just being able to invest the way that you would like to invest? Do you value, what is it about money that you value? And what are some of your values that you have as relates to, you know, as relates to money? I know, think about that for a minute. Just think about, like, what are my values? What do I value? Do I value time? Do I value freedom? Do I value being able to have fun? What are some of my values? Because oftentimes what you value oftentimes shows up in your habits. So if I value freedom, then my habit when it comes around money is making sure that I prepare in advance so I can have that, you know, particular freedom. Also, what shows up is a money personality. Now, you don't have to answer this, but if you think about it, are you more of a spender meaning that as soon as you receive money into your household, you are ready to spend the money? Are you a shopper? I know I was guilty of it in the past, that as soon as I received some money, that it's Friday, just got paid. Wait a minute, I need to do a little retail therapy because I don't work hard the whole entire week. So I am ready to bust out the seams to go, you know, shopping. Are you one that is more of a saver, that soon as you do get paid, that you're able to save money, but at the same time, you don't take a risk to go and enjoy, you know, life? Understanding your different money personality helps you when it comes time to developing your personal spending plan. It allows you to see where you are consistent and what area that you do need to do a little bit better, as well as what area that I may need to have a little bit more growth in. Also, as it relates to who am I when it comes to our money narrative, is thinking about what are some of your current money habits. For example, do you consistently shop? Do you use couponing when you're shopping? How often do you set a time to look at how much money is coming in versus how much money is going out? Do you have a habit in terms of, did I constantly pay my bills on time, or am I paying my bills a little late? Another, you know, habit may be, do I constantly may give money without thinking about it? Or am I constantly borrowing money after I have, you know, spent, you know, money? So thinking about what and who I am as relates to, you know, money. And then another area is oftentimes, and I mentioned it earlier, is what are our feelings? What is my feelings around money? Meaning that when I'm angry, do I tend to spend a little bit more than usual? Or if I'm feeling really good or excited, do I tend to don't stick to my particular budget and I go out and splurge a little bit more than needed? Or I may be feeling sad that I'm just doing any and everything with my, you know, money. So oftentimes we may have some emotions that may be driving us to do areas or things that may be unhealthy, that may, you know, cost a little bit more than we expected. Or oftentimes within our fun and our money, we may go to places that for recreation that we utilize as a pastime, but oftentimes may end up hurting us in the long, you know, in the long run. So it is, how do we feel about money? What do we do when we're upset? How do we calm ourselves, you know, down? Or then sometimes do we get hooked on buying subscriptions to magazines that we do not, you know, do not read, or we may get extra memberships that we may not need to utilize? Over the past year, just since being in this particular pandemic, I value exercise. So of course I had a gym membership, but then when the pandemic came, it realized to me, well, you know, I had to create my own home gym that now that I got accustomed to, now I'm sitting here looking at saying, do I want to continue to pay the gym this particular membership, or can I now use that money for something else? So this is a good time to look at what is the value and how much, in terms of what you value, what you would like to spend on that, and how much is that particular, you know, worth. So we'll talk about that a little bit more. Oftentimes when we look at our money narrative in terms of who we are, we kind of tend to look back in terms of what was our childhood experiences like around money. What did our parents, or what did our caregivers, or what did our friends that we grew up with, what was it like within money? Did you know that anytime like your parents got paid, you knew when they got paid because you might have went out to dinner, had a little shopping spree or different, you know, things, or was money, you know, tight? What was some of the behavior and habits that you may have picked up from your family of origin that you may carry into your adulthood? And the reason why I like to start with my families and with friends and just talking about that is really understanding who we are about money and what is those areas that we would like to change as we are working on our money selves and our money goals in terms of moving, you know, forward in terms of some of the things. Oh, this is what I do with, you know, money. Are there any questions in the chat thus far? Anything? I know, I think so. Someone said they're a shopper and they're a saver. So definitely that is who I am when you think about money, like who am I together? So now that you kind of have an idea about who you are and what your current, you know, money story, and a beautiful thing about your money narrative, at any moment, you can change that narrative. At any given moment, you can say, you know what, that is my, you know, story. I may have been I may have spent a little bit too much over here, but I can shift and have that balance of being a saver, of being an investor. I can begin to create new money, you know, habits and stories about what I would like to be. And oftentimes you hear the discussion of doing a lot of legacy building for those who are coming up behind, in terms of, I may not have been educated a lot about money, but I could take the opportunity to learn more and be able to develop and create new habits, which would then allow me to begin to teach others and continue to plant those seeds of financial wealth. The second part, and you may think about, well, how does this fit into budgeting? It all ties together because it starts on the inside out. Yeah, so I see a question about vision boards, and I will definitely have an answer to that as well. So, and this is also part that goes into your vision board. When we talk about money goals, is really the why. Why do I want this wealth? Why do I want this abundance to come into me? Begin to think about it, and it comes into your particular goals, is that I want to be wealthy because I want to do X, Y, and Z. I want to leave this type of legacy. I want to be able to give more. This is the reason why. And when you have that why and understanding, it helps you stay on task with your particular goals, which then will help you stay on task with what I'm budgeting, and help you stay on task with your personal spending plan, because I understand what my vision is. I understand what my financial goals is. And so now I know how I want to direct my spending. I know how I want to direct my saving. I know how I want to direct my investing. I know how I want to direct my giving, that no matter what is happening and going around me, I have already placed that in my particular goals to think and put that in my particular budget, you know, plan. So your philosophy about money is, what do I think about money? I used to grow up with this particular saying, because I heard it so much, you know, because my mother used to say it to me. She's like, look, I need you to work. I need you to do X, Y, and Z, because guess what? Money don't grow on trees. Money don't grow on trees. So if it doesn't grow on trees, where is the money coming from? Because I kept going to ask her, you know, for something. But that was something, the things that we grow up with. I know within my faith community growing up, people used to always say, well, money is the root of evil. That wasn't correct. It says the love of money is the root of evil, because also at the same time, it says money answereth all things. So oftentimes if something has been passed down incorrectly, we kind of hold on to that. But the, you know, I share that to say is being able to help you understand what is your philosophy of money. What are the principles? What are the values that you tend to live by as relates to your life, as relates to your particular money? I know one of the principles that I tend to, you know, live by is that I operate off of tithes. I'm a faith-based and I'm a believer. So I tend to operate on tithes, that 10% of what comes into my hand as abundance, I automatically return that back to God. That's just one of the principles that I grew up with within my family. And that's something that I tend to, you know, live by. And that's something that's oftentimes allocated within my personal spending plan, that I have a portion that is set aside that I use for, you know, giving. And this is very important when you think about what are my goals in life. And so you have, we heard it before, you know, SMART goals, which are specific, measurable, achievable, and realistic within a time frame of our particular goals. So oftentimes our goals can be broken down into three, you know, areas. Our long-term goals, which are goals that we like to achieve pretty much over 5 years. So you're looking at sometimes your retirement goals. If I want to buy a house in another 10 years, something that's going to be kind of long, you know, term, those are your long-term, you know, goal. When you understand what your long-term goal is, then you can shift and say, you know, when I start to build and plan for my retirement, I know I can use this particular strategy because it's going to be, you know, long-term. How do I incorporate that particular long-term goal within my budget or personal spending plan? I value retirement at this particular age. So I, you know, part of my goal is to make sure that I'm increasing in my saving and investment, because retirement, that is a goal for me. I want to have that time freedom. So you can see how your values now start to turn into your goals, which starts to turn into your budgeting plan. Your immediate goals, are those goals anywhere between 1 to 5 years? So oftentimes you may have a car right now, which is a beautiful thing. You're like, oh, I like this car, but on my vision board, I can see me driving maybe a Lexus or maybe that Mercedes, you know, in a few more, you know, your years. So that whatever that dream car is, begin to start planning out for that particular goal. Or I may decide I want to move. I may decide to get married, or I may decide to start a, you know, family, or I may want to start my own business. So those are those particular goals where you begin to count out the cost to say, well, how much is this going to be and what that is going to look like? Sometimes immediate, you know, goals or even long-term goals may be dealing with student loan. Oftentimes, you know, within the pandemic and emergencies may come up that we may also be dealing with some type of debt that we may be working on conquering. We hear everything's like, I want to live a debt-free, you know, lifestyle. I want to be debt-free by a certain age. We begin to start writing those goals, and within our particular budget, what does that, you know, look like? Then our short-term goals can be anywhere from something as simple as like 1 day, 1 month to a 1 year. What is that short-term? What is that immediate, you know, goal that you are working on? So when you begin to think about creating and developing and designing your budget or personal, you know, spending plan is, what are my goals? What is it that I want to achieve, you know, financially within the next year, 2 years, 5 years of retirement? And as you begin to put those things in those different areas, then it helps you be able to look at your personal spending plan on how I now want to develop my plan that is consistent in alignment with my goals, which is consistent with my vision. Someone asked the question, how often do you do a particular vision board? And there's two, you know, thoughts of, there's two things with that. Oftentimes vision boards have been very popular, because that's the thing that everyone does, like at the first of the year, we're going to do this, you know, vision, you know, board. I have a vision for my life. And a vision board is a visual representation of those things that you want to manifest in your life. So based on that, a lot of people tend to, or some people, and based on you, do a new vision board once everything that they have put on their vision board has been achieved. So that's how often some people may do a new vision board. Some people may say, I have just a vision where it's just a picture of what I would like to achieve over my particular life. But each year I may update my goal plan for that particular year, which is something different. So the vision or the picture, they may keep up just as inspiration, as motivation to say, you know what, those days that I feel like I'm tired, I don't want to go on anymore, I keep looking at that picture because that's my why, that gives me the push and an extra drive. But at the same time, I just may update my goal plan, which may be updated on a monthly basis or a quarterly basis, like once I have checked off this particular, you know, goal, because there's different, you know, steps to it. So it really just depends on what your style is and what will motivate you to keep you going and for you to be engaged to on your path to financial freedom. Everything about your personal spending plan is about you. So it's uniquely, you know, tailored. So it's not going to be every year that this is the way that you have to do it. It's based on you and your life circumstances, because guess what? Life is constantly ever changing. Our lives are changing now. Our life last year looks completely different from this year. And so last year, a lot of things, people were, a lot of creativity. It's like, you know, I want to do this. I want to save this amount of money. But guess what? The pandemic hit us. So a lot of people said, you know, I won't be able to save as much as I want to because I may not be working as many hours because a lot of places were closed. A lot of businesses for at least for the first 90 days, you know, from March almost to June was pretty much at a standstill. So that was pretty 90 days worth. So that money that might've been allocated to try to go for saving pretty much went to just trying to keep things at a even still and just to stay afloat. So now a lot of individuals are revamping their budget plans to kind of catch up to say, okay, you know what? We kind of went down to some area. So now we're trying to build, you know, back up. So constantly you are reevaluating and realigning and readjusting your personal spending, you know, plan based on your goals, based on what's happening with life and what's going on at that particular time. And so that is very key when you are doing your plan. Does anyone have any questions of information that I just shared thus far? So here it is, effective budgeting. So when I was reading this or just taking into consideration and just kind of shift my thought about what a budget is. So a budget is a paper or an electronic device used to record both planned and actual income and expenditures over a period of time. So what it just simply means is whether you use, if you're a paper person or you're an electronic person, I'm still paper. I have a notebook and that's the way that I do my particular budget. I get that habit because that's the way I watched my mom do her budget and how she paid her bills. And it was, you know, simplistic. I still tend to do paper. I know a lot of the younger version and different individuals who are very tech savvy, they kind of have a budgeting app and use that. So it's really up to you which style and which method works well for you. The thing is, you want to find a method and style that you will be consistent with. that is easy for you to follow. A budgeting, as we talked about, personal plan, is definitely what it is. It's definitely a plan for saving and spending. It's very, you know, very simple. So when you look at it, it's this particular plan for saving and it's plan for spending. Based on your need, based on your life circumstances, based on what's going on today, your budget is going to look different at the end of the year than where it started at the beginning of the year. It's going to look completely different from, you know, last year, because there's different things that's happening in within the environment, within our economy. If you notice last year that a lot of the prices, especially as it relates to, you know, gas and food, they were very low. Because we were in this pandemic and it was kind of shortage and people weren't, you know, kind of, you know, buying that much. If you notice now with the economy of the world starting to slowly open back up, you see the fluctuation in gas prices. They're, you know, slowly, surely getting higher and higher each day. If you look at sometimes the cost of your food, it has gone up a few cents than what it was last year. So oftentimes that is something that you may need to take into consideration. Whereas you might have been utilizing a certain amount for food, say maybe $150 may cover for your gas and food. It worked because we weren't really driving anywhere. We were staying in the house. And so that particular piece is different now. You have to calculate, oh my goodness gracious, the price of food, the price of gas is going up. So we have inflation, which is a silent, you know, killer, that food and cost is slowly increasing, but the worth of our dollar is not increasing at the same level. So oftentimes that causes people to feel, you know, a little upside down in their particular, you know, budgeting and as relates to the income. But this is what budgeting also, when you're developing your personal spending plan, it forces you to consider what is important in life. So remember we talked earlier, what is it that you value? Because it shows up in your budgeting. It shows up in what are my areas that are non-negotiable when it comes to my budget. It forces you to look at, okay, these are the things I can negotiate with, meaning that all my non-negotiables, I make sure I pay them on time. Those areas that I can negotiate with, I may have a little, you know, wiggle room to say, you know what, I can't pay you today, but I can pay you, you know, next week. And then there's some, I call it the A, B, and C, my C's. Those are areas that I may spend on, but if I'm in a crunch, I'm in a pinch, I can immediately cut those out. I'm like, okay, there's no, those are the ones that have to get cut immediately. So like a gym membership, although I may like it, if I had to choose between that extra $25 or $30 that I may pay for the gym or put it towards a food, you know, to make sure I have enough money for food or gas, the gym is something that gets, you know, cut because my basic needs need to make sure that are, you know, met. It also forces you to see like what things you want to own, you know, how do you want to live, what it would take to do that, and more importantly, what you want to achieve in life. So those, putting all those components together, goes into what we can spend some time and have some conversation about, is how do I effectively budget. This is just a simple template. It's on a bi-weekly budget, but it's something that you can look at and think about. So one of the things that when it comes to budgeting and developing your personal spending plan is, one, first, taking into account all the income that you receive within that particular month. And when you look at the income, what is your source of income? Is that coming from your job? And if it is coming from your job, how often is that? You get paid once a month, or do you get paid, you know, twice a month? Or do you get paid weekly? And once you understand that, if it is once a month, then what is that amount that I have to work with for the month? If it's biweekly, what is that, you know, what is that particular, what are those amounts biweekly? And if it's weekly, what are those amounts? And being able, as you see across, because this is bi, you know, biweekly, being able to know when you will be receiving that particular income. So that's for a job. And so you want to start out with like, what am I coming in when I'm, you know, when I'm receiving that income and how, you know, how much? What are other sources of income that may come in that particular month? And you want to do the same thing, you know, how much you may have a rental property and I may, you may receive, you know, this is hypothetically speaking, and an extra, you know, $500 a month. Is that something that comes in and when? So you want to, you know, start at the top with what that is and know that particular amount and have, you know, roughly, is it the first and third Friday of the month, biweekly, every two weeks. If I get paid on the 15th and the 30th of the month, you want to have that as a frame for you to start in terms of any income that may come in and be able to know what that source of income and what those particular totals may be. The next thing is that once you have your income, then of course, below is that is will be your expenses. And this is everything that you are planning to pay for that particular month that you have to, you know, pay out. So being able to write down my mortgage, my rent, car insurance, maintenance for the car, or if it's transportation, you know, costs. They broke it up in different, you know, categories. Anything, car, you know, if you want to go to the car wash, how often do you like to get your car, you know, washed and, you know, clean or, you know, detail? Begin to kind of think about almost everything that you spend your money on. If you give to your church, if you give to family, you know, relatives, if you value giving, if you give to an organization, giving to help other individuals out within your organization that's giving, you want to be able to kind of calculate that, you know, piece. Do you have a regular home phone plus a cell phone, the cable bill, streaming, everything, entertainment. If you have children, sports, recreation, you know, hobbies, those, everything you want to list out that you pay out. Additionally, next to that, which you list and how much you owe, you want to put, is this particular expense due? What day in a month is this particular expense due? And the purpose you want to look at that, because it gives you an ideal to say, you know, within the, you know, 4 weeks within a month, you may see that your budget is saying, personal plan to say, you know, within the first 2 weeks of every month, I am hit hard. It seems like everyone and everybody is due the first, between the first and the 15th of the month. Within those particular bills, you may be able to negotiate to say, can I move this particular bill to the last 2 weeks of the month? So as you observe and assess your budget, your personal spending plan, you're able to see who is due and what is due. If you're unable to do that, then you may want to look at the strategy in terms of how I am paying. And when I say strategy, you know, for instance, car insurance, there's a strategy, you know, around car insurance that if you pay on a monthly, basis, there's usually like a payment, you know, plan, which is definitely, you know, fine. You may have a credit card that I may utilize. So they may say, you know what, you need to pay this, but you don't get paid to the end of the month. You may utilize your credit card to pay your car insurance so that it's on time, knowing that at the end of the month, then you will just pay off your credit card, that particular car, you know, car insurance. So there's different strategies that if you're unable to negotiate to pay a particular bill, move it to a different point of the month, then you may be able to see how you are managing your credit card and say, you know, I may pay some of my bills using a credit card, and that when I get my second pay, I'm going to be diligent enough to make sure I just pay off my, you know, credit card. It, you know, serves as two purposes. One, it shows that you're consistently utilizing your credit and that you're able to manage your, you know, credit, and that you are paying your bills on time and building up a payment, you know, history. So that is, you know, when you look at different, you know, your budget, then you begin to look at different strategies in terms of what is the best way that I'm able to manage my particular, you know, budget. Oftentimes we forget to, you know, include, you know, having a budget for vacation. Yes, I want to go on vacation, but really being able to count up the costs in terms of how much does it cost to go on vacation, which includes food, which includes flight, all those different, you know, areas. Oftentimes thinking about birthdays, you know, holidays, you want to begin to include that in your budget as well, in terms of what are some of your holiday traditions around, you know, Christmas. If you do, you know, Kwanzaa or different, you know, gift giving, are you setting a budget aside for that, you know, piece? And now is actually a good time, or at the beginning of the, you know, the year, to kind of save up for your holiday, you know, expenses, so you're not going into debt at the end of the year. So once you have all these areas written down in your budget, then you can begin to sit down and negotiate with a simple calculator in terms of what are my priorities as relates to those bill dates. So between the 1st and the 15th, what are the bills that I must pay here between the 1st and the 15th? And does that add up to the income that's coming that will carry me for the 1st through the 15th of the month? And if it does, and it ends up being zero, then that's you have adjust enough to make sure that everything is, you know, paid. You do the same thing for the second, you know, part. And this is if you get paid, you know, biweekly. If you're paid once a month, then your strategy is going to look a little bit different, because you need to know where your bills are, where they fall out, you know, in the, you know, month, unless you have, unless you utilize, say, maybe like a credit card that allows you, you know, $5,000, and you pay your bills on that. And as soon as you're paid, then you're paying off your credit card, or how you negotiate your particular, you know, savings on that particular, you know, plan. So those are different, you know, strategies. Of course, if you are paid, you know, weekly, you're looking at that. You're also looking at some of the strategies with, you know, car payments and mortgages, in terms of paying an additional balance to your car or your mortgage with that extra check that some of us may receive if we're paid, you know, biweekly. Some people may utilize the strategy that I will pay my car payment instead of making one, I pay it in half, like every 2 weeks I am making that particular, you know, payment. So it's really looking at your, you know, personal household and what works best for you. But some of the core foundation is being able to have on a piece of paper outline all of your income for the month, then being able to look at those dates that you receive that income and how much, and being able to add up all your particular expenses, and at that piece, being able to develop a particular plan on terms of, when do I want to pay this particular bill? Is this easier to be on the first? Is this on the at the towards the end of the month? And being able to call those different places to find out what is the grace period for paying bills, which has definitely been very helpful, you know, for me, that, you know, some places like your mortgage, they give you up until the 15th, you know, of the month to be able to pay that. So really understanding the grace period before you are charged a late fee for not having it in on time. And yes, there are times that we may have to incur a late fee, you know, life happens, but don't let that, you know, get you down, but being able to really just kind of stay on top of that. So questions that you may, you know, want to ask yourself is, how many of you like to do a budget and like to, you know, write your own personal spending plan? How many? I know I don't. Go ahead, question.
Yeah, I have a question about the budget itself. Mm-hmm. I know, you know, sometimes for me, moving from biweekly to now once a month, now that I moved from Maryland back to North Carolina, I'm getting paid once a month at the end of the month. Mm-hmm. That was like really difficult for me. Because right. Now I have to try to call and change everything. And then at the end of the month, when I do get paid, I try my best to pay all my bills, but you never know what's going to happen within those 30 days, you know, until you paycheck to paycheck. You're not quite sure what will happen. So you try to budget up enough where you can kind of put some money to the side. But again, you know, car could fail or something, what so have you. And my question is, how can a person that moves from biweekly or just living from month to month, what is the best strategy for them living monthly?
Well, I think definitely being able to save a cushion, being able to have some emergency. This is my, you know, cushion, you know, here that this is the pinch to hold over, being able to save up something if you're able to do that. Additionally, not knowing, because a lot of people say, you know, I save that's kind of cash, but something, you know, happens. If you're very good with navigating your particular credit, you know, card, knowing your particular, you know, limit on that particular, you know, card, so you can have it. I may use my credit card as if something happens in emergency, that's what I may, you know, utilize it for, or I could do the reverse in terms of, I know I'm going to get paid and this is how I pay my bill. So that's, you know, done. And so immediately, as soon as I get paid, I need to make sure that I pay off that particular credit card. In either situation, you definitely have to make sure that you are diligent and that you pay it all, either way. And you take, you know, say what is best in terms of what will be the interest, what will be the greatest in terms of, you know, interest. You want the lowest, you know, think, if I'm going to pay this off, it's here. So if something happens to my car, do I want to put that car on my credit card, knowing that that's the interest I'm going to be paying over and over, or I know I need to pay this, you know, bill, which may be smaller, that I know once I get paid, I'm able to pay that off. It's going to be what you are comfortable with. And you may try one strategy one month, and you may try something different a different month, but it's something that you are, you know, comfort in doing, if that makes sense.
Yeah, so what I tried to do was to look at, like you said, which one is the smallest. And I tried to maybe say, okay, I'm gonna split this up in 3 months and this is what I'm gonna pay. And then once I finish that, I take that payment and I may add it to another payment, to another bill, and I just slowly have been working it that way. I try my best on like the note app or something on my computer, and I just write out all my bills each month to see, and then kind of look month to month to see which one I can maybe add a little bit more to it,
right?
To pay it off. But that's the way we've been doing.
And that's the reason why I say personal, it works for you. And that is the comfort, and that meets your comfort level in terms of style. I know I have a strategy that is not going to go over for a month. I pay it over. Then the next, I'll look at this. But one of the key things that you just mentioned, which is key, is that at the end of the month, I am constantly looking at what came in for that particular month and what went out that month. So I know I have an idea of what I'm working with the next month. And so that's the key to that, is making sure that you have consistency with that piece in terms of what you are paying for. Any other questions? I think I did see a question.
Question says, do you pay the one with the largest interest rate first?
There's two, you know, methods with that, you know, piece in terms of the snowball, you know, method, or, you know, avalanche, you know, method. Looking at your particular, you know, bills, oftentimes people pay off the smallest bill first because it gives them a sense of accomplishment and achievement in terms of, oh, I knocked off this particular bill. I can take that and now add it to the next bill. Or now I want to tackle the interest, the highest interest rate first, and then work my way back down to the smallest. So it really depends on your particular style and what you want to do. But when it comes to motivation level, a lot of people pay the smallest bill off first because it gives them that sense of accomplishment versus the highest interest rate, which may take a little bit more time to knock that particular bill off. And that person may give up easy, like, oh my gosh, it's going to take here. I'm never going to get, you know, here. I won't have that sense of reward versus, oh wow, this bill, you know, it's $100. Okay, you know, I can pretty much do that within the next 4 months. Something simple is $25 and I can knock that off. Or, you know, I got $80, put 80 and 20, whatever works and whichever is comfortable. The thing is, whatever you choose to do, you want to make sure that you are comfortable that after you have paid your non-negotiable, you know, these are the priority. After I pay the priority, whatever is left that is extra that I'm able to give towards debt payoff, then you want to be able to be comfortable that A, you have something that you're setting aside for saving just in case something may happen. The life fund, you know, put in $5, $10, $15 right there. So you're not constantly seeing yourself in debt more, and then being able to work either way with the smallest or being able to take the top. But once again, it's very what you are comfortable with doing. And so when you look at that, you'll be able to find out and say, you know what, this is the highest, this is the longest. And oftentimes there are debt, you know, calculators that you can use or see, well, how long is it going to take me to pay this particular, you know, bill off, or which here. And so oftentimes people utilize the Alamance, you know, method. I pay off this. Now there's $50 that I used to make this particular payment. Now I just add it to the next payment and begin to start knocking out the particular debt, you know, first. And depending on what you have, some people may just take half of that payment. So if I have $50 and I'm knocked out, then I know I will just take the extra 25 and add it to the next payment. And then I began to take the $25 and just have something there, because life happens. In a pandemic, you have different, you know, individuals say you should do X, Y, and Z, do this way or this way. I'm always under pressure, what is best for your household? A lot of the experts aren't living in a household with you, but you are living in a household with yourself, and you know what is best. So I say, you know, look at that here and then begin to develop a plan that A, that you are comfortable comfortable with. Any other questions? Yeah, so definitely for those who are, you know, retiree, yes, paying budgeting is so very crucial, because everything has to be paid. And definitely in terms of, as you mentioned, in terms of taxes, oftentimes if you're self-employed, making sure that you set aside money to pay your particular, you know, taxes at the end of the year when it's time for, taxes. For those who receive the stimulus, you know, payment, making sure that you're checking with your tax preparer to see, you know, how you are reporting that on your taxes for next year in terms of what we have, you know, received. So that that is very crucial to think about some unexpected, you know, expenses that you may have to pay. And of course, part of your budget, personal spending plan, is making sure that you do take the time to save for yourself, save for a life, you know, fund, whatever that may be. Even if it's just something starting out small as $25 per pay, $25 per month, you want to get in the habit of being able to save and pay, pay yourself. Does this seem like something that you're able to take away and to work with in terms of moving forward, in terms of developing a particular plan?
I would say for me, yes. One of the things that I've done, I bank at State Employees here in North Carolina. And
okay.
What they do here, they have something called summer pay, cash pay account, okay. Summer account. And so what I do is, because my school system, and I started with Guilford County when I was working with Guilford County. I'm now in Wake County, and they do not pay teachers over the summer. So we 10-month pay. So what I started to do was to budget out pretty much how much I wanted to have over the summer. On top of, I added a little bit for if I want to travel.
Right.
So with that being said, I would have my regular pay versus the amount that I want to travel, you know, within the 2 months. And so that's how I kind of budget out for myself. And one thing I do like about the summer cash account is the fact that you cannot touch it. You won't even see it on your banking account. When you go online, you won't even see it. And so if I do decide to go in, they would just pretty much cash out all of my funds, and then you can't use it until another year, but you really don't see it. So it's almost like you just have missing money sitting there. And then right. When the 2 months come, they would cut it in two payments and pretty much just drop it in your account like you're getting paid direct deposit.
Yeah.
So that helps out a lot.
That's definitely great. And a lot of the different financial, a lot of the banking centers have very great apps that you can utilize. My Pocket Planner, I'm with State Employees Credit Union here in Maryland. So they have like a financial, you know, center, my virtual financial center. So, you know, they want to set up an appointment if you want to talk to someone about your finances. So definitely, I say utilize the resources that are within your own banking, you know, community that they may have. There's definitely various websites. YAB, it stands for You Need a Budget. Sorry, YNAB, You Need a Budget, which is an online budget budgeting app, depending on your particular style. Some individuals still do like the Excel spreadsheet in terms on their particular, you know, computer. It just works for them. Whichever method that you choose to utilize, be consistent, you know, with it. It's about being able to have an idea of what you want to do with your money and where do you want to see your money to go. And so that way it helps out with, okay, this week I need to be mindful how I'm spending. So if I want to go on vacation, I may say, you know what, I'm good. I'm not eating out for the month. I'm going to go ahead and just stick to my food budget. So that way I can go out to the end. Definitely, if it is a credit union in your area, utilize that particular resources, because they are a lot of free money, you know, resources to help raise your financial, you know, awareness. But ultimately, it's you and your relationship with, you know, money. So that's why we kind of started out with you. What are your habits? What is it that I need to do to be more disciplined, to, you know, follow through, make sure that I'm not over, you know, spending or even overextending? It may be a good thing, but is it for me to, you know, be able to give? And so I go through a litany of, you know, things. I had an accountability buddy today. I was out trying to search. I like to shop in Aldi, and they had the exercise bike came out this week. So I've been going to like three or four different stores trying to find this extra, you know, exercise bike. Now, mind you, it's not in the budget, but I'm like, oh, I can do that. I can, you know, I can do that. But then, you know, my accountability buddy was like, well, didn't you just purchase a little mini something last, like a couple of months ago? I was like, well, yeah, but this is the, I'm like, but this is Aldi. Like, this is like the weekly circle. Like, this is here. But I was grateful for that accountability because it kind of put me back into check and realized, now, you know, you really don't need to go ahead and spend that money that you really don't need. You need to put that aside. But I share that. That is just as quick that we can easily get off our goals and budget due to, you know, a sale. So we have to be, you know, mindful. So even me, even though I talk about money, I'm budgeting here. Even me, I have my particular moment. So that's part of my strategy is being able to have comfortable and have, you know, accountability partner that I'm able to spiral, you know, my financial choices and decisions. So I'm not going down a path and help me bring it back to, okay, this is my goal. This is what you said you wanted. I'm due. How can you better utilize that particular money that you were getting ready to, you know, spend, although it was discount, was it for you, meant for you to spend at this moment in time?
And it's okay to shop off brand.
Yes.
And thrift is good as well.
listen now. We haven't got a chance to get there, but yes, off brand and a thrift store.
Yes,
the Goodwill, and once you find out the days, 50% off at the Goodwill,
mm-hmm.
the last day of the month, the last Saturday of the month, 50% off those colors that they have.
Oh, let me take note. I didn't know that.
Listen. Yes, I love it. You know, lesson. So definitely, you find out the days that they have like 50% off, and the days that they go by their particular colors. Value Village, if you have one in the community, is also another thrift store. You find out what days that they have their, you know, their sales on and get an extra 5% invite. Coupons definitely are a lifesaver as well. I don't know if you remember that movie on the TV show Extreme Couponing. Yes, I've seen that, and I've seen, you know, people have done that and literally walk out without paying anything. It is strategy. It does take some time to strategize and know what stores, you know, getting all those particular circulars and coupons. But if you are in terms of looking to stretch your dollars within a particular budget, that is definitely way in terms of some of your favorite, you know, items. Because I say every 5 cent, every 15 cents, every 50 cent, every dollar helps. So that is definitely, you know, strategy, reward points. I don't know if you travel, but definitely if you do have a particular, you know, credit card, oftentimes a lot of them, you're able to earn reward points for each time that you use. So that is an incentive to utilize your credit card. So oftentimes, instead of using your debit card, use your credit card so you can, you know, get those particular reward points, you know, back as well. And definitely it is a lot safer not going to different, you know, places that if someone were to hack, you know, try to steal, you know, credit card, you're able to get that money back like right away versus if you use your debit card, oftentimes it's a little challenge to get all that money particularly back. But once you're able to use some of the different strategies to do that, you're here constantly. So as long as you're consistent with your budget and utilizing these different strategies, then that helps you transition over anytime you get an increase, being able to put something, you know, aside to save. So a lot of people, some were blessed to get two or three different stimulus, you know, checks would either A, help them through or to pay down some debt, or people utilize that to say, okay, you know, I'm gonna take this money. I haven't been investing in a while. Let me put that towards an investment. So now it can start to grow on my half because I was able to drop a large, you know, chunk of money in at that particular time.
Any other questions?
No, just Lori, no question per se, but just, you know, good information. Most of the information that you're saying and going over, I definitely do. Like you said, those credit cards, getting the perks, So if you have to go to a hardware store, and if that's your 5% for the month on that credit card, pay with your credit card, then pay it right back, mm-hmm. so that you won't accumulate anything. Mm-hmm. As far as being paid bi-weekly, but me, I try to do all my payments at the beginning of the month. Like 99%, I don't even know half the time when my bills is due, because I make sure that I had found a way that I can just pay them all at the beginning of the month. Mm-hmm. If I can pay extra, like on the bills, say for instance, the light bill, the gas bill, bills that normally don't change so mm-hmm. often, and just pay extra, maybe pay 3 months in advance, that mm-hmm. way you could put money elsewhere. You know, I usually try to do that also. So yeah, I just be trying the different strategies and different things. And then also, you know, the savings that go straight out of my account, so I don't again see that, and it's going straight over to right. another account, a savings account. So yeah, everything mm-hmm. you saying, I definitely try my best to do monthly in regards to it.
Yeah,
and I still do the paper. I still do the paper, like you said, because I write that down monthly. write down all my bills and do it on paper.
That paper is not the game. That's like one of the easiest things to do. You just go to the dollar store, get your little dollar journal, and you yep. just write, you know, just get in here. And one of the things is really great, you know, in terms of when you're looking at that, say, where do I need to make changes in my budget, is begin to track and see where you're spending your money and how you're spending your money. And oftentimes for a lot of individuals, that becomes an eye opener when they realize like Starbucks was getting a little bit too much of my money. And I said, oh, this relationship is going to have to end. Like, what? And you start multiplying that up towards the end of the year. You'd be like, oh, no, this relationship is going to have to, you know, end. So those little things like that. And as you mentioned with the utilities, that's the same thing. Being able to keep your house at the temperature that they said to utilize it. So I try to keep in the springtime, like 65, you know, keep it there with that thermostat and try to utilize it in a manner that I'm most energy efficient, because it does keep my bill down. I'm turning off all the lights in the household. Mm-hmm. I'm using a surge protector. Oh, we're gonna plug into this right, you know, here. So every little thing helps. Filling up gas, like I try not to keep stuff in my car, because extra stuff in my car drags my car down. So I'm using more gas than what is needed. So if anything is possible, be able to do that, be able to fill up your gas tank in the morning, because by the end of the day, that price is for change. So I'm learning that particular strategy. Like, wait a minute, in the morning, this was $2.65. Why, when I come home from work, we at $2.71. Oh no, I need my extra 5 cents. So I'm gonna fill up.
And on a certain day of the weeks. That Monday, Tuesday to go ahead. Right.
Thank you. So listen, so once you begin to start realizing the little hacks, it helps you knowing when to fill up, when to get gas, when to shop, and how to do a whole different things. And these are the little things that you do to kind of keep your money to mm-hmm. kind of stretch, even with grocery shopping in between Walmart, Aldi, and a grocery store. Them circulars at this, you know, same day. And I think as Margie mentioned earlier, listen, I'm gonna tell you a trick about Aldi. If you're not a fan of the Aldi, they package the same thing as your name brand stuff mm-hmm. at the same meal.
Yeah.
Only thing that is different is that bag.
That's it.
That's it. But it's all packaged at the same meal.
Mm-hmm.
So don't, you know, if you're very creative, and as my friends and family used to say growing up, if you know how to cook, you can make some things happen.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But, you know, definitely, you know, here. And so when you look at that and you find like, oh, I could get what I like, and I'm able to substitute this in here, and I have an extra $5 or $10 to go over here, that may be that extra $10 you could put towards something, you know, something else. So.
Also with Miss Lori's talking about speaking on this, paying extra things mm-hmm. like your credit card or either your yes. car payment, make sure that extra payment, you send that separately and say that this is to the principal.
Yes.
Because if not, when you send right. that extra payment, they're going to take the interest out. So make yep. sure anything that you pay over what they ask you monthly, mm-hmm. you make sure you write that's mm-hmm. the separate payment, and make sure you write that's the interest. So it's really making a dent in it. So.
Yeah, and definitely you, and if you, another thing is like within your particular, you know, bills, if you're not doing it on a monthly basis, but at least on a quarterly basis, making sure that you go check your accounts online and, you know, payments, that everything is being applied properly. Because oftentimes you'd be like, what did this, you know, happen? I had a situation with my car note. I was faithfully like, okay, here. And come to find out they had gave me a discount. Well, they called it a discount. So I was paying my car note, but everything was going to the principal because I guess because of the pandemic, they called themselves trying to help me out. I didn't ask for the discount, but I said, okay, went to the principal. But sure enough, came January this year, when I paid, they took whatever that interest was supposed to have been over the past 3 months. Wow. Like, you know, here, they took that out. But everything still balanced, it balanced out. I was just like, wow, okay. But that just was an eye opener to make sure that I'm paying attention to what is going, you know, here, because oftentimes they may do little different things. So you want to make sure that you are constantly looking at your, you know, bills, anything that you even do pay automatically, you know, be able to check. And don't be afraid to renegotiate some things.
Yes.
Like your car insurance, you know, telephone bill, you know, the cable bill stream. Do not each and every year, because everyone wants clients, everyone wants customers. So do not be afraid, especially if you've been with a particular company over 10, 15 years. Do not be afraid to be able to go, you know, ask and say, hey, I've been a loyal customer for such and such. What can you do for me? So that's
you don't even have to say that. You just say, I just want to disconnect my cable. Right. And they're going to try to renegotiate and give you the best deal, because deals change all the time. Someone told me that, and I started doing that, and I started saving a lot of money. Mm-hmm. I know with Duke Power, I'm in Fayetteville now, so it's PWC, but with Duke Power, you could call and ask them to put you on a budget plan where you pay the same amount every month, no matter what your bill is. A lot of times, of course, with me, mine was a lot lower than what I actually paid. So maybe I paid $60 a month all year. My bill maybe came up to $40, but they took that extra money and just kind of set it to the side. Mm-hmm. So then when I left Durham, that extra money paid the final bill, and then I had money left over that I received a check. So it's probably best to call and see if they have that budget plan where you can just pay one fee.
So those little things that you're able to do when you're looking at, you know, your personal spending plan and being able to utilize other people's resources, you know, other people's money to help stretch to get you to your particular goal that is, you know, needed. So constantly reviewing and consistency and just, you know, talking, you know, accountability individuals and utilizing the different strategies that work well for you and your household.
Everything's negotiable. You just got to ask.
Yes. You have not because you asked not. That's what they said. So once again, thank you everyone for just allowing me just to share my evening with you. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
So we would like to thank Ms. Dr. Parks, Sora Parks, I say, Shandra, for coming and agreeing. She was one of the ones when I just, of course, we came up with the plan to do this week. And I just put a post on Facebook and just asked, you know, these are the topics that I need. And she was one of the first ones to kind of jump on and say, I can do effective budgeting, which is needed. I know I need it. And so I just thank her for coming. Dr. Parks, is there a way that they can get in contact with you if they need
some help? Definitely. You can find me on Facebook, www.soul2soul. Wellness.
Okay. I'll try to see if it's on here.
And then you can definitely email me at shanparks895@gmail.com.
Okay. Can you say that one more time?
shanparks895@gmail.com.
Thank you so much. I'm hoping that this week is helping everyone. It has helped me. I have learned a lot from just starting from day one with the taxes and learning about our credit to moving to discussing financial freedom with our youth. Next, the last night we talked about investment in stock and now effective budgeting. So I'm so excited about this week, and it has actually really helped some other people. I will say that if you are interested in joining the National Council of Negro Women, we do have a section in the Alamance-Guilford section, and they are across the country. We have them in other states as well, and we have other sections in North Carolina. If you want to find a section in your local area, you can email me at alamancegilfordncnw@gmail.com. You can also find us on Facebook and also Instagram at alamancegilfordncnw. And we definitely will put you in contact with someone in your area. Also, as you can see, we have various affiliate organizations here. And so you also can join through your affiliate organizations. And if you need a list, you can also find that list on ncnw.org. We are actually starting a youth section here. So we are looking for young men and women to join between the ages of 11 to 18. For us, they need to reside in Guilford and Alamance County. And of course, there are other sections that also have a youth section as well. We promote academic excellence, we promote community involvement, we promote leadership skills, and we connect our youth to our leaders. If you are interested in joining or you're signing your child up, you can contact our third vice president, Teresa Whitsett, at the email that you see below. If you are, again, interested in joining our adult section, we also have an adult section. And if you are interested, please, again, email me, Margie McLean, at alamancegilfordncnw@gmail.com. All right, so we have our last night tomorrow, which I hate for it to end. We have two special guests, which is going to be Miss talking about small businesses, and we have Miss Anissa Short and Miss Michelle Ballard. Miss Anissa Short will be coming on to talk to us about the benefits of having a small business, and Miss Ballard will come and talk to us about how to fund that small business. So I hope that you will join us again. Tomorrow's it, and I hate for it to end, but we don't want to hold you hostage the whole week. So and of course, there's more, and we'll be back with some more as well. Before I end, I cannot end this without saying thank you to our host, Miss Susette Jones. I appreciate everything. She has really been instrumental to our section as well. Our correspondence secretary, she gets the information in and get it out there to us. And I just asked her, hey, can you send this email? And she is on it. So I thank her for joining and also hosting, even though she was a little shaky about using Zoom and what so have you. So thank you. You did an awesome job. And again, Dr. Parks or Sora or Shandra, thank you.
No problem. For
coming on. And thank you again. Do you have any last words?
No, thank you, everyone, and happy budgeting and happy developing your personal plan.
Thank you again, and I hope to see you tomorrow. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Bye.